Good afternoon, everybody. My name's Associate Professor Belinda Lloyd, and I'm Associate Professor of Addiction Studies at Monash University and Head of Research and Workforce Development here at Turning Point, and also Head of Population Health Research here at Turning Point. And absolutely delighted that you could all come today, and it was a fairly short notice advertising around this particular seminar, and I think that the great attendance is evidence that in recent years, interest in data and the use of data has really changed. I was just remarking to someone the other day that when I came to Turning Point, which was about 7.5 years ago now, the term data nerd was something that people would be embarrassed about, and if you said it in a meeting, people go, oh, don't call yourself that, don't insult yourself. But now it's something that people embrace, and more people are clamouring to get their hands on data and to be able to have robust evidence to be able to support decision making around planning, around policy development, around service delivery and evaluation of service delivery. So it's my absolute pleasure today to have you all here for us to be able to talk about the joy of data and how we can use big data to support our planning, our policy and our intervention approaches. And I'm just providing a very quick introduction now, and we'll be handing over to my colleagues Jessica Killian and Fiona Barker, who'll be talking about different aspects of the use of data and making it useful for specific purposes. And then you'll be back with me at the end, where I'm pretending to be Sharon Matthews and talking about ambulance data and what we do with that. So about how we maximise the utility of these different systems. So what we'll be talking about today quite broadly is how we use a range of different data to be able to inform decision-making processes and to be able to better understand the populations that we serve and to be able to inform the activities that we do. So there'll be an opportunity for questions at the end. And just to let you know, we're recording the session today, so for the sake of the presenters and also for the sake of recording, if you can turn your mobile phones onto silent, that would be great. And we'll have an opportunity for questions and comments at the end, but we don't record the questions and comments, so feel free to say whatever you fancy and ask whichever questions you like, because that won't be recorded. That's for our internal discussion here today. So I welcome Jessica to take over now and talk about mapping and the use of a range of different data sets around AOD stats.
Thanks, Belinda. So today I'll be talking about using interactive mapping statistical tools for large data sources. But just to give you a bit of a background, Turning Point, we hold many data sets, over 30 different data sources related to AOD uses and harms. And so we've been compiling and analysing these data over many years now. And many of you are probably aware or knew of our old annual statistical handbooks. We had an alcohol statistical handbook. We also had a drug statistical handbook. And these describe the major patterns of alcohol and drug use, as well as associated harms in Victoria. And these handbooks were produced each year and were typically released quite a few years behind the current available data. And they're in large PDF formats, you know, difficult to, scroll through, and, you know, took time to print and everything like that. So in 2013, we went through a redevelopment process with the Department of Health and Human Services, and we adopted a new reporting method for these statistics in 2014. And this replaced our two annual publications into the online interactive website for alcohol and drug statistics. And this means an improved timeliness and usefulness of the data. Data analysis for AOD stats involves a collation and analysis of information from an extensive range of data sources. As I said, we have many at Turning Point. And provides comprehensive and timely information about AOD-related statistics. The data, the sources, just to name a few of them, we include ambulance attendances, emergency department presentations, hospital admissions, deaths, treatment services, serious road injuries, assaults and domestic violence incidents. We chose to use software called StatPlanet Plus. It's a mapping software tool. It's a model that has been used by quite a few other organisations. The Australian Heart Foundation have used it, the World Health Organisation have used it as well, and so that's just a few people that have used it. It did take around 18 months initially to set up and redevelop all of the text information into an online mapping tool, and this is growing and will grow over time, and it will be a much more efficient and timely data source in the future. It's a very convenient statistical resource for policy planners, drug service providers, health professionals, researchers, and any other key stakeholders interested. The website started with three drug categories. So we had alcohol, we had illicit drugs all grouped together, and pharmaceutical drugs grouped together as well for both numbers and rates. We've recently begun to expand the drug categories. So the first drug group that we have released is the stimulant methamphetamine group. And in the next coming months, we will be releasing or expanding those into other drug groups such as heroin and benzodiazepines and all our other drug groups. There are two mats. We have one for the whole of Victoria and then another one with different for the Victorian LGAs. The website's updated quarterly on a quarterly basis.
Sorry, what's an LGA?
A local government area. So your local council area pretty much, yeah. And there's the website there, and I will take you to have a look when I finish going through a few of my slides. So the next few slides, I've got some static results I've taken from the website. And these are just some of the increases and decreases you can see. Pretty much most of them have been increases. For alcohol-related ambulance attendances, this has increased significantly between 2003-04 financial year to 2012-13, so increased by about 70%. Emergency department presentations, rates have increased 37%. Assault rates have increased 21%. Family violence by 53%, and treatment services rates have increased marginally by about 12%. That was alcohol involved, yeah, just for alcohol, yeah. So as I said, this data is taken directly from AOD stats in a static form and showing an increased trend over time, going from around 4,000 cases in 2003-04 to around 7,500 cases in 2012-13. The map in 2003-04 at the lowest end of the colour gradient scale, which goes from yellow to dark green, on the left, and then up on the right, you've got in the dark green for 2012-13. For alcohol-related assaults, similar, we've got an increase over time, again from yellow to dark green, with the map ranging from around 5,000 in 2003-04 to around 12,500 in 2012-13. Around 5,000 in 2003-04 to about 7,500 in 2012-13. And then family violence, it's the next one. This one increases from around 5,000 in 2003-04 to around 12,500 at the top here in 2012-13. So they're just a few slides that I've shown you to give you an example of what the website can show you. The website has been going for over 12 months now. We launched in October 2014, and we have quite a few plans in the future to expand the website. And these include adding some further data sets, adding more age group data, perhaps gender by age group as well, and also, as I mentioned, expanding out the drug groups. There are also some modules that are available within the software that may enhance it as well, which will allow more functionality. For example, comparing between categories, so comparing between age and gender and those characteristics. And also we have the potential to add further maps. We could add a metro-rural map, so you could compare the metro-rural data as well. And there may be capacity in the future to have all this information on one map. As I mentioned, at the moment they're in separate maps. We're hoping with more software developments, this will all be available in the one map. Sorry, I didn't press the slide. That was just what I said there. So interactive mapping tools can improve timeliness of data for government policy development and efficiency and efficient AOD services. Since we launched, AOD stats have primarily been used by state government, but also local government, councils, even police intelligence, and also researchers. In the past, local and state government and researchers would have to wait quite a few years for annual reports to be released, and so the data would be quite old. So now they have access to the data at any time, and it's updated on a quarterly basis, and we're continually improving it and adding more things to it. AOD Stats provides a framework for expansion to incorporate additional data sets, other jurisdictions, additional maps, and also for use in specific projects. So now I'd like to take you to the website, just to give you a brief. So this is our website. So this is the LGA map. And when you first start, you see these little bubbles. You select an indicator, or you select your region, and you've got your map of Victoria down the bottom. So these are our local council government areas. And I can select alcohol, for example. Deaths as an example. I'm going to try and find Melbourne just to make it easy, but yeah, so you can select which area you'd like. You've got the graph down here which shows in a colour gradient increasing numbers as the colour gets darker. You've also got a play button down the bottom here, and that actually plays from the first year to the last year. So if I just press play, you'll see it scroll across the numbers. So that's deaths. And as I mentioned, illicit drugs, which are grouped together at the moment, but I did mention we have split out, we've taken out methamphetamine, crystal meth and other stimulants as our first drug category that we've released. And we'll be releasing more in the next few months. At the moment, I can just show you that as an example. So that's for methamphetamine, amphetamine as a group. To the peninsula, and then we've got our council areas. So that's AOD Stats for you.
I'm going to talk about demand modelling, developing data methods for needs-based planning. So in other words, it's using data to assist with needs-based planning. So firstly, why on earth are we doing this work? Well, we're interested in developing methods that can help with planning, forecasting, resource allocation, etc., for the AOD and broader health sectors. But there's actually very little work that's been done in this area. Despite the obvious importance of planning and forecasting, health planners actually have very few tools to use for assessing and modeling service demand and need. There's growing evidence that alcohol and other drug problems are interconnected with a range of other life issues that influence client outcomes. A broader approach to treatment accounts for these life complexities and forms part of our needs-based planning in Victoria. The tiered model that you can see here was originally developed by Professor Brian Rush in Canada, and it's a model that integrates AOD problem severity with issues related to life complexity. So you can see that triangle there. So the lower tiers, which is the bottom of the triangle, they represent services, they represent lower levels of problem severity. So these are people whose needs can be met by less intensive or less specialized care. And then the higher tiers, so the people at the top of the triangle, those are people with the highest level of problem severity whose needs will be met by the more costly and specialized, more intensive types of treatment. So the lower tiers represent the general population, and they're the largest group. And the upper tiers, the top of the triangle, they're the smallest group and the ones with the most severe and more complex problems. So our model is based on the original Rush model, but we've modified it based on the data that we had available in Australia. We've had multiple different revisions of this model, but I'm going to show you the version that we're currently on at the moment. So very simply, it reflects increasing AOD problem severity and a range of life complexity measures. So at the moment, we've got 8 different complexity measures. We've got poor mental health, lack of employment or attendance at school, housing, pregnancy, gambling issues, care of children, and poor physical health. So this table on the right here, you can see, tiers 1 and 2 represent people who don't score as having any drug dependence. Tiers 3 to 5 are those individuals who identify as having likely dependence, and then from 3 to 4 to 5, it's increasing numbers of complexity factors. So that's how we've developed our model at the moment. So the lower tiers identify needs such as health promotion, early intervention, and this is done so that it might be possible to identify individuals whose needs might be able to be met outside of the specialist AOD treatment system. And then the higher tiers identify people who need increasing levels of treatment and other support such as care and recovery coordination. So how can we use this? So I'm going to give you two little examples of how we've used this model and how it might be useful in helping us interpret and understand some data. So I'm going to present two different models, a retrospective and a prospective linkage examples. And just for those who haven't heard the language around linkage, basically linkage is where we take data sets and we link them together based on client characteristics. And we do that to enhance the data that we have and to provide more valuable information on the service, the services that are used and the characteristics of the people accessing those services. So I'm going to start with the retrospective linkage example to begin with, so looking back in time. So basically, we collected consents from people who completed the standard AOD screen. So we collected consents from people within a consortia who was participating in the project, and we also collected consents from people who completed the online screen. So we have the standard AOD screen online. So we collected consents from those two groups of people, and then we linked their data to the AOD treatment database, or ADIS, and ambulance attendances. And so from those two groups, we managed to get 514 people who consented to have their data linked. And this is what that cohort looked like. There were more males than females, average age of about 34. Most were first-time treatment seekers, most were likely dependent, and alcohol was the primary drug that people were concerned about. Now, if we take their screening data and we run it through the model that I've just described, this is what the cohort looks like. So of those 514 people, 18% of those people were categorized as tier 1 and 2, meaning that they might be able to have their needs met through online services or counseling online or telephone services or other referral services. The remaining 82% are likely to require full assessment. And about 1/5 have a high degree of complexity and are likely to need high intensity of treatment and a whole range of other support and wraparound services depending on their issues. Now, this is where I think it gets interesting. So we can take the screening data and we can map it to the ambulance data and the AOD treatment data. So you're looking at the red bars, so the ones, the second of the two bars. This is looking at ambulance attendances only. So the red bars, the second bars, are the people who had ambulance attendances. So basically what you can see from this is, as you increase to the right, which is increasing problem severity and complexity, so increasing tier, probability of having had a previous ambulance attendance increases. So hopefully that's clear. So I'll show you another slide with the next set of data. We see the same trend. So this is for AOD treatment episodes. So as the person's complexity and severity increases, they're more likely to have had a previous treatment episode. Hopefully that makes sense. So just showing that the model that we've developed seems to be reflecting this increase in problem severity and complexity. Now, if we put these data sets together as sort of a preliminary surrogate way of trying to capture service burden or intensity of service use. So we put the three data sets together. We've got people who didn't have an ambulance attendance or an AOD treatment episode, people who had both, and people who had one or the other. So the top part of the bar is the people who had neither, and then the bottom three are the people who had one or the other or both. And if you just look at how that's increasing over time, we see the same trend again. So as people increase in terms of their problem severity and complexity, their burden on various services actually increases. So this provides a really clear indication that there's needs for strong links between AOD-specific services and other support services. Now, I'm just going to very quickly show you the other example, so the prospective example, so taking a chunk of data and looking forwards in time. So basically, we took 1 year of individuals who were in the AOD treatment data set, and we followed them for 3 years, and we linked them to hospital admissions data and emergency department data. And that cohort looked quite similar, predominantly males, similar age range. again, most were identified as likely dependent, and again, alcohol was the primary drug of concern. So if we do the same thing as that final graph, the trend isn't quite as strong, but it's still there. Same kind of thing. As you increase in terms of clients' levels of problem severity and complexity, their increased burden on the system is evident. So that trend goes up to the right. So we were actually really surprised. We didn't expect to see that it would work this well. So we were quite pleased to see that the model that we had developed seems to be reflecting client characteristics in terms of both their existing characteristics and their demand on services in the past and in the present. So this gives us confidence that the model we've developed accurately reflects client complexity and problem severity. So we've just started with this, and there's lots of opportunities for this kind of model and the playing with data that we've been doing. So the data linkage stuff is only just the tip of the iceberg. There's lots more we would like to do with this. There's some really interesting opportunities for evaluating treatment pathways and client outcomes, because outcome studies are actually really quite expensive. But if we could incorporate linkage and look at client outcomes over time this way, it's much, much easier and much more cost-effective than actually trying to follow people. There's options also to look at trends as predictors for resource need, and also we can use this to provide some valuable information about access to treatment services. So lots of ideas, very exciting, and we're just at the very start. So that's me.
Thank you to Jess and to Fiona for both of those presentations. And I guess so far, so we've showing different parts of the picture of how we can use data and how it can be made to be more useful for different purposes. So bringing together multiple data sets as we do in AOD stats gives us a much more complete picture of alcohol and drug-related harms, either at a local area level or at a whole population level. If we just look at one indicator like hospitalisations, for example, in alcohol-related harms, that's only one part of the picture, because not everybody who experiences acute and often quite severe alcohol-related harms ends up as an inpatient in hospital, nor do they necessarily end up in an emergency department, or at times they will only end up in the criminal justice system, or they may end up across multiple systems. So to be able to bring those different indicators together gives us a much more complete picture of the impact of alcohol and drug use and alcohol and drug-related harms at an individual, a community, a service and system level, and the impacts then on different services. And then moving on to the data presented by Fiona around demand modelling, that being able to bring data sets together and link them to be able to understand how people engage with different systems over time really gives us a much better indication both of the treatment needs and opportunities for engagement with people who are experiencing harms associated with alcohol and drugs, but also for us to be able to better understand how people transition through different systems and how that use might change over time, for us to be able to design better systems to better support individuals and better support services to be able to respond appropriately. So I'm going to be talking now about how we enhance data that's routinely collected to give us more information to be able to support what we do. And I'll be talking today about the AMBO project. And again, many people may have heard about this. I seem to constantly talk about this data, but it certainly gives an indication of how we can enhance data that's currently available. So that's what I'll be talking about right now. So alcohol and drug-related harms have a significant impact on the community, and we could certainly see that through AOD stats and through demand modelling data. Many of the harms aren't necessarily readily identifiable, and we don't necessarily capture that information very well in individual data sets. So national surveys like the National Drug Strategy Household Survey can be quite useful for us understanding use of substances at a population level, but have limited utility for lower prevalence drug use because of sampling biases. And also when we're looking at specific populations or trying to better understand harm, many people are missed in those kinds of data collections. You need to be in a household, so marginalised populations tend to be missed, and people don't necessarily report on their behaviours and are much less likely to report on harms that they've experienced. Other data systems also have limitations in terms of the information we have around alcohol and drug-related harm. So for detailed information around substances involved in harm, the most reliable data that we have traditionally had is around coronial cases where there's toxicology reports. And there are some obvious limitations to that. So there are many harms associated with alcohol and drug use that don't result in death. So it's a very small proportion of cases result in an unnatural death that would then be reviewed by a coroner. There's also a challenge because that data is not very timely. Due to the nature of coronial investigations, it can be over 3 years before cases are finalised. So that information doesn't really give us the opportunity to respond in a timely way to emerging issues. We also know that hospitalisations data and police data and many other data systems on their own have some challenges in the capacity to be able to identify substances involved in presentation and to be able to look at that at a whole population level, that there is quite significant underreporting for a range of different reasons. Ambulance service records provide us with a great opportunity to be able to better understand these kinds of harms at a population level and in populations we might not otherwise have data available. So what I'll be talking about today is data from the Victorian component of the AMBO project work that we do. And in that work we have data available from mid-1998 with regional data available from May 2011. We capture information quite extensively around alcohol and drug involvement and acute alcohol and drug involvement in presentations to ambulance. And from July 2012, this work has extended in terms of mental health related presentations and self-harm related presentations to include cases with or without alcohol and drug involvement that cover suicide, suicide attempt, suicidal ideation, self-injury, self-injury threat, and people presenting with current mental health symptoms. So there's very detailed information. This work has also expanded in the last few years to include New South Wales, Queensland, ACT, Tasmania, and we're currently working with South Australia and Northern Territory with their data. So it's expanded to be a national project. For Victoria, data are updated monthly and reporting is available within 2 months of an event. So as an example, an ambulance attendance today in February 2016, information relating to those attendances will be available, analysed and ready for policy response purposes and interpretation purposes in April 2016. So it's a very quick turnaround in terms of being able to respond quickly to emerging issues. So just very briefly, and you may not be able to see this well, this is an example of the coding system that we use. So this isn't as simple a process as receiving some data and doing a little bit of quick cleaning and then doing some analysis and there it's ready to go. We actually have a process with ambulance services where they provide data to us on a monthly basis. And data is made available electronically in most jurisdictions. It's actually paper-based in South Australia, where we run a filter through the electronic records that paramedics complete and select cases that are potentially alcohol and drug, mental health or self-harm related. Then there's an extensive process of preparation and cleaning of that data before a team of dedicated and highly trained data coders go through the case notes of the paramedics as well as the clinical assessment the paramedics make to be able to identify substances involved in presentation, mental health or self-harm components to the presentation. And you may or may not be able to see here, this is one of the coding screens. So information is brought forward for the coders to be able to read through the case notes of the paramedics as well as be able to examine clinical factors associated with the presentation to ambulance. And then there are a series of tabs that the coders work through around different substances involved, around self-harm and mental health, and contextual factors around the presentation. So it's a very detailed information system. And it takes quite a lot of work, and I was coding some data just before I came down here today. So it's quite an involved process, and paramedics vary quite a bit in how they report information. But consistently, they like to tell a story of what's happened around the event. So that's where the most useful information comes from. So the data that we receive is quite extensive, and much of that is actually made available through the information that's directly collected by paramedics, but also by the information that is coded by our clinical coders. And so we have detailed information regarding the patient, so their gender and their age, the geographic location of the event, so and down to the geospatial coordinates, so it really gives us the capacity to look at specific locations, the time of day and day of week, the type of location, so a public outdoor space, for example, is quite useful when we're thinking about alcohol intoxication and public drinking regulation, the outcome, whether or not the patient was transported to hospital, and if they weren't, why they weren't, a whole range of clinical data, whether or not police co-attend, overdose intent, so we capture information about whether an overdose was accidental, intentional, or whether there was unknown intent based on the information available, mental health status, and single drug use or polydrug use involved in the presentation. So what do we capture in terms of drugs included in the coding? It's quite an extensive list, and actually this isn't the complete list. So on the left-hand side of the screen, there are a range of illicit substances there. We code separately for crystal meth or ice to other amphetamines, so we can specifically look at those kinds of cases, for example. We code for emerging psychoactive substances. We code for synthetic cannabinoids separately to cannabis. And this is a condensed list of the illicit drugs that are coded for. Importantly, on the right-hand side of the screen, we code for a range of illicit substances and in a very detailed way. So alcohol involvement as well as alcohol intoxication, a range of pharmaceutical drugs, both prescribed and over-the-counter medications, and there are the drug groups there, but we code for specific preparations. So for those of you who are interested in this space, as an example, we can and we have investigated patterns among different types of drugs within drug groups. So it's possible to be thinking not just of opioid analgesics as a group, but looking at cases that involve methadone versus fentanyl versus oxycodone versus Targan, a range of different preparations. We've recently done some work around atypical antipsychotics amid increasing concern regarding the prescription and the diversion and the misuse of quetiapine or Seroquel, and been able to compare that with other atypical antipsychotics, so subgroups within groups. We capture information on drugs like alprazolam and so have the capacity to be able to explore changes that have potentially occurred as a result of the rescheduling of that benzodiazepine and whether there's a shift to the use of other benzodiazepines as involved in acute harm. So it's very detailed information. So why do we have a team of coders who actually go through and do all of this additional work? Why don't we just use the data as it's made available and not do all of that additional coding? It's quite time consuming and it's very detailed. The primary purpose of the data collection by paramedics is clinical and administrative. It's not for research purposes, and it's not specifically for monitoring purposes around alcohol and drug or mental health. And it's not appropriate to expect paramedics to collect that level of detailed information in a systematic way while they're on the scene, managing often chaotic situations, multiple people, and trying to stabilise a patient to either transport them or refer them to other services. So it's certainly not a criticism of paramedics. They do a fantastic job and we certainly wouldn't expect any changes to their practice. It's their data collection is done in ways that are most appropriate to their setting and we work around that. But we would miss a significant proportion of cases if we didn't do that additional coding. So if we just relied on the original coding by paramedics, we'd miss around 65% of acute alcohol intoxication cases, around 80% of medication-related cases, 55% of illicit drug-related cases, and nearly 90% of suicide of suicide-related cases or self-harm-related cases. So it's certainly a significant underrepresentation if we don't do that additional work. So we've done a great deal of audit with paramedic data to be able to identify what would be missed. And this is one of the reasons why we have such good relationships with ambulance services, because this additional work allows them to be able to better understand the true burden of alcohol and drug and mental health on their services and then respond appropriately in terms of developing professional development and training opportunities for paramedics, but also to be able to better report the impact on their services. So when we're talking about alcohol and drug, we define drug involvement in the context of this particular project as the immediate or very recent over or inappropriate use of a substance directly relating to the ambulance call out. So as a good example, if somebody has alcoholic liver cirrhosis but they haven't been drinking, we wouldn't include those cases. There are many, many, many conditions that have a partial alcohol attribution to them, but we don't have enough information to determine that etiology. Likewise, if somebody is taking a medication as prescribed and has an adverse reaction, we don't code that information. It's the immediate or very recent over or inappropriate use of a substance. So I'll just give you a little bit of a taste of the data, and there's much more detailed information that's available online, so feel free to contact if you want more. So this is just a little bit of an overview of metropolitan and regional data for 1 year, and these are illicit drugs. And what we can see here is, for the most part, the rates of attendances for illicit substances are lower in regional areas and higher in metropolitan areas, which is something that's fairly consistent with other information we have. And this is true except for cannabis, where we actually see higher rates of attendance in regional areas than we do in metropolitan areas. In terms of alcohol and pharmaceuticals, alcohol-related attendances are more common in metro areas. But for most pharmaceutical drugs, we actually see higher rates of attendance in regional areas. And there are a range of factors that will be driving these kinds of patterns, including drug availability, as just one consideration. So what can we see over a longer time period? This is metropolitan Melbourne data, because we have it for a particularly long time period. But I guess the key thing here is to note that the line that keeps on going up and 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 up, that's acute alcohol intoxication with no other drugs involved. So alcohol only. These cases relate to alcohol poisoning or very severe intoxication, and also injuries as a result of falls, of motor vehicle accidents, of fights, as a consequence of that intoxication. So the patient is heavily intoxicated on the scene. And just to give you a little bit of context, the line that starts up higher and drops down and then wiggles along, those are heroin-related attendances. The second most common drug-related ambulance call-out that we see and have seen for a very long period of time is for benzodiazepines. So again, for a pharmaceutical drug group, so illicit substances by far and away make up the greatest bulk of ambulance attendances that are alcohol and drug-related. Just down the bottom of the screen, and I'm colourblind, so forgive me, but I believe it's a green line and a red line. Green is cannabis, red is amphetamines, and as you can see, they've both been tracking up over the last few years. And just in terms of alcohol-related attendances, so these are those alcohol-only attendances, so no other drug involved, and it's really important for us to be able to identify those cases because we often hear from the alcohol industry that alcohol-related harm isn't actually alcohol-related harm. Mm-hmm. Alcohol-related violence in nighttime economies has nothing to do with alcohol whatsoever. It's illicit drugs. It's all those bad, bad illicit drugs. It's never alcohol. And in fact, someone from another jurisdiction recently told me, it was the Northern Territory, that there was never a problem with violence in the Northern Territory until ICE came along. There was never an issue with alcohol. I have to say, I was not much shocks me anymore, but that was quite surprising. So these are alcohol-only related attendances. We can look at alcohol and other drugs together, and certainly there have been shifts in polydrug use over the last decade or so. And when I started out in alcohol and drug research, it was an exception rather than a rule in many circles for the use of ecstasy and related drugs and alcohol at the same time. If you're going to have a stimulant, why would you have a CNS depressant? That's really shifted over the last decade or two. So there are shifts in drug use and we need to recognise that. I guess a couple of the key things, we're continuing to see upward trends in alcohol-related harms. It's true. We are seeing shifts in how people consume alcohol though. So while we're seeing increases in alcohol-related harm, the cohorts are starting to shift. And I guess one of the key things to highlight here, whilst it wasn't a significant change over the 2 years, is the average age of people attended for acute alcohol intoxication, and it's the early 40s. And what we've seen over the last decade is the group of people who are increasing in terms of alcohol-related call-outs, alcohol-only, acutely intoxicated to the point where you need an ambulance, are people aged in their 50s and 60s and above. So we're seeing a real shift in that acute alcohol-related harm. At a community level, we tend to think of people being that intoxicated as being young people, behaving badly, but we're seeing a real increase in older cohorts as well. And actually, more abstaining from alcohol in younger cohorts. Police co-attendance is a really significant part of these presentations, that it's not just one emergency service on the scene, it tends to be multiple emergency services on the scene. And we see it's around 70% of people who are attended for acute intoxication are transported to the ED. We know that people leave before they're treated in the ED quite often, and it's only about 13% of people who are transported to the ED acutely alcohol intoxicated who end up being hospitalised. So this is where we see the greatest burden in terms of alcohol-related harms, in that emergency kind of setting. So just quickly, this kind of data allows us to map clusters of harms, and this was a really quick map that was pulled together a couple of years ago for the department actually around heroin-related attendances in North Richmond. So to say, oh, at a postcode level there are lots of heroin-related attendances is nothing new. But this information was around specific locations and where there were hotspots of heroin-related attendances over a two-year period of time. And that kind of information is useful when we're thinking about local responses in terms of peer support and outreach, in terms of environmental changes like changing lighting and those kinds of things to reduce these kinds of harms. This kind of data also allows us to do work around time, using the data over a longer time series to be able to support resourcing and planning and developing and evaluating operational practices. So this was a project that was conducted with funding from Vic Health. This is just a little bit of the information here. These are acute alcohol intoxication cases across ambulance, ED and hospital around public holidays. And so the red is where there was a far greater number of events than you would normally expect on that day of week at that time of year. And we looked at the day before, the day of and the day after the public holiday. And what we found, and we looked at other indicators as well of alcohol-related harm, but what we found consistently is that it's the day before the public holiday, not the day of the public holiday, where we see those acute alcohol-related harms. So all of the information that's made available on the nightly news the night before a public holiday about being responsible in your drinking and keeping your mates safe and making sure you pace yourself and all of those kinds of things. And each year we do see those stories in the nightly news the night before a public holiday. By the time those stories are broadcast, the people that they're meant to be targeting are already out, they're already intoxicated, and many of them are already being seen by ambulance, being picked up by police, or in the emergency department. So thinking about this allows us to then be able to explore where we might target education and prevention and how we think about how people drink and how people experience harm. We've also done some work using time series modelling around the implementation of different kinds of regulations, like public drinking, for example, to be able to identify whether or not different kinds of interventions like those, so either legislative interventions or other interventions, actually have a significant impact on harms that we see. So because it's a long time series of data and we have every event every day, it gives us that capacity to be able to evaluate the impact of change. We've recently just provided some data as well to New South Wales Treasury around their evaluation of the legislation changes for alcohol in New South Wales, like the lockout, for example, that's received a lot of media attention lately, to be able to examine alcohol-related harms and also alcohol-related violence in the areas where those where that legislation applies, so in the CBD. So this kind of information gives us a range of opportunities. There's so much we can do with it beyond making beautiful graphs. It allows us to be able to support training and ongoing workforce development for paramedics, but also for other services and systems as well. It provides support for local area level planning and responses, because without an evidence base, we have real challenges in being able to develop appropriate responses at that local area level. It gives us capacity for evaluation, for resourcing, and also to be able to determine measurable change. Often programs and strategies will be implemented without an evidence base. And so that poses some real challenges to be able to determine whether there's actually been a measurable change and if the measurable change has been a good thing or a bad thing. So some interventions actually increase harm, and we need to be able to identify what works and what doesn't. We're currently in the process of redeveloping our database so that we're able to code for violence and also family violence, both proximal to the ambulance attendant, so violence either before or during the attendance, and whether the patient is perpetrator, victim, or both. And that has particular relevance also to occupational violence, but also family violence, both proximal and distal to the ambulance attendant. It's a really common feature in the experience of patients who are attended by ambulance, both for alcohol and drug events, but also for self-harm and mental health events. This gives us capacity to estimate direct and indirect costs to services and also to systems. We're looking forward to linking health law enforcement and welfare data in the future to be able to understand how people engage with different systems, and identification of emerging issues for strategic and operational planning and prioritisation. We all know there are very limited resources available, so the reality is we need to be looking at how we best direct those resources to be able to get the most benefit for the community. So I'd just like to acknowledge on behalf of my co-presenters as well today, the Victorian Department of Health and Human Services, that has funded a range of activity that we've presented, the Demand Modelling Project Team, the AOD Stats Project Team, the AMBO Project Team, the Patient Pathways Project Team, Ambulance Victoria, who has been very helpful in working with us over many years, the various data custodians we work with and who are very supportive of the activity and very responsive, and also Professor Brian Rush. These are our contact details. Does anybody have any questions?